standing by for a call from Barbados. And I know that we're going to be tremendously blessed by this testimony from Mya Daniel. Read a snippet of it in the Barbados media, and I was like, yes, I've got to share this one with the family. Want to thank my daughter Shadi for sending me her music from Barbados. I tell you, it was a time when some storm was threatening, and Shadi tuned into the local radio station on in Barbados, heard this song, and she remembered her mama. And she sent this song and she said, Mommy, you've got to get this song. Of course, I trust their judgment, the young people, you know. If they say that a song is good, yes? So I looked it up. I liked it. Bought a couple of songs on the album. And curiosity led me to researching her. I tell you, Google is the bomb, yes? So I researched up Mya Daniel, and I tell you, her story is remarkable. And so I want to go to the phone lines this morning and see if our dear sister Mya is here. Contacted her, and she was so gracious and willing to talk with us. Her song here says, I've got a testimony. I've got a testimony, she says. Mya, are you there?
Hi, good morning.
Oh, good morning. How are you today?
I'm well, Angela. How are you?
I am so blessed, and I am really, really happy to welcome you to Joy Gospel Radio FM.
Thank you. It's a pleasure and honor to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right. Let's play a little bit of this song. I've got a testimony.
All right.
It's exactly 10 o'clock on Joy Gospel Radio FM. We're streaming out of Tortola in the beautiful Virgin Islands. My name is Angela Burns. Thank you so much, family, from across the U.S., the U.K., Barbados, the Virgin Islands, for joining us today. We are delighted to have you. Got somebody in the Netherlands as well who's with us, and in the U.K. God bless you richly. We want to welcome to Joy Gospel Radio FM our Wednesday interview for today, Mya Daniel. And I just want to ask you, Mya, as we begin this interview, to introduce yourself to the family.
Hi, Radio Land. My name is Mya Daniel. I am from the beautiful island of Barbados. I am a worshiper. Let's start there. I'm a worshiper. I am a wife. I am a mother. I am an attorney at law. I'm a mediator. And I love a good laugh. I know by my smile, there are times I may go somewhere and someone may see me and say, I know this face, I know this face. And as soon as I smile, they say my name. So there you have it.
Okay, that's awesome. All right, I was trying to get some pictures up with you there. I went on your Facebook page and on Google. I tell you, I love me some Google. Google just gives you everything you need, right?
So everything. That's right.
So I have some pictures up of you so that the folk can see who you are, because we do video streaming as well. And so,
oh, wow.
Yes, while we're talking to you, we have your picture up, and so they can see who we're talking to. All right.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Yes,
okay.
So you are an attorney at law, you're a mediator, you're a wife, you're a mother, you're a worshiper. Give us your life story, because I know there's more to you than that. You're a preacher's kid?
Pardon me?
Are you a preacher's kid as well?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
So tell us about your early beginnings, your growing up.
All right, well, my dad and my mom came out of very strong Christian family homes, and both their parents were involved in pastoral work, and so it's no surprise then that, you know, they ended up together. My mom was not into pastoral work, but very involved as a preacher's kid herself, you know. But my dad eventually went into that line of work of a ministry, and so I've known him as a minister all my life, and he has served in the New Testament Church of God for many, many years. As we grew up, that's where we were based. And then some years ago, maybe about 20 odd years ago, God called him to another ministry, another work. And so we thought he was crazy leaving lovely big church, lovely organization as children to go, you know, to sit in a, you know, in an auditorium with just the four of us, you know, me, mommy, my sister, and my dad. But he knew what God was saying to him, and it was for that time. And so we started that ministry, Trinity Ministries, and that's where we are to this day. We grew up as preacher's kids and doing everything that preacher's kids are supposed to do. You're involved in everything. You're in every choir. You're in Sunday school. You are, you're busy with, you know, performing and being a part of all that's happening in church. You're at church morning, noon, and night. Back in those days, with the Spirit of God, you were at church a lot.
Yes.
And so, but it stood us in good stead because, you know, we have not departed from it. So I give God thanks for that. I gave my life to the Lord perhaps when I was probably around somewhere between 9 and 11. I remember going to General Assembly of the Testament Church of God in Atlanta, Georgia, as a young girl, and there was a separate kids church. It was called Sunshine Avenue. So while the General Assembly was happening, there was this kids church, and I remember seeing children at the altar. I mean, over the course of the time that we were there, I mean, really pressing into God. Little children, tiny tots, some much younger than myself, some my age, some a bit older, some speaking in tongues, prophesying, and, you know, and these children yearning after God. And I thought to myself, you know, I want this, I want that, you know. And I mean, I've been in church all my life and never, you know, was in the world that kind of way, but I felt like there was something I needed that was still missing. So even though I was involved in church and so on, I felt like there was something more. And I remember going up to that altar and weeping my little heart out, and I just remember feeling this hand on my back, because my dad is a heavy set guy, you know. I remember feeling this hand on my back, this rubbing, and when I looked, it was my dad, and it was such a special moment, you know. And he just let me have my moment to just say what I had to say to the Lord. He prayed with me and so on. And that's where it really began. I had been singing, I've been involved in everything. I was always into the theater arts as well, in school and all that. And but I knew that my calling was going to be in ministry somehow. I always had a love for the law, always had a passion for the law. And I knew that that was going to be a part of my life as well. But in terms of my spiritual growth and my spiritual life, I knew that this would play a big role for me. And so I was involved in New Testament National Soul Children, a big children's choir, and the director, Mr. Shelton Perkins, gave me a lead. It was simple lead, Yes, Jesus Loves Me. And that's where my solo ministry began, with just that simple little song, Yes, Jesus Loves Me. And from there, you know, others saw the potential and so on. I got some voice training for about a year. Then they, you know, persons started inviting me to minister at different events and functions and weddings and this and that and the next thing, and concerts, and more concerts and different churches and so on. And yeah, that's where it all began. I used to sing with my mom and my sister as well. My dad used to do lots of tent crusades back in the day. And we would usually minister before he preached the word. And so that was also very, very special for us as a family too. To go all around with him, whatever he was doing, the tent ministry or ministering, and we would sing before he brought the word. Yes.
So you came from a musical family as well?
Oh, yes, very much so, on both sides.
On both sides?
Both sides. Right. Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
It was inevitable very that you much. Really got into the music and the ministry in that respect.
Yes, I believe that was my destiny.
All right, so, I mean, you were going along nice and fine, hunky-dory, nice little church girl, and what happened at a certain point in your life that... Yes, go ahead.
Yes, I had started doing my law degree at the University of the West Indies here, and I remember it was first year, first semester, I believe, or the second semester, and I, because it was February of 1998, that's correct. And I was sitting in a politics class one evening and just started to feel a little under the weather. feeling like I was coming down with something, as you would say. And so my good friend took me over, said, you know, you're not too well, probably let me get you over to the main admin building so you can get home and, you know, get some medication and wrap up and so on. So we walked over to the admin building and I went home, took some probably Panadol, multi symptoms, the usual thing. And yeah, I just tried to sleep it off and so on. But as, you know, the days went by, I got worse. Nothing was shaking, you know, it was shaking this thing. And no matter what we did, nothing was shaking this thing. And then my parents noticed that my breathing was getting a little bit strange. And then my tummy area became distended, swollen. And they said, well, something's not right here. So at that time, dengue fever was rampant in Barbados. And they thought that perhaps it might have been some strain of the dengue fever. That was the first natural conclusion. Then they took me to one doctor and they said, oh, she's just dehydrated. Give her some synaptogen and she'll be fine. Not knowing that all this time my system was being poisoned. Then one night they took me to our general practitioner who had been to before. But on that night, he took some blood and put me on a drip and so on. And he said he's going to just observe this blood for a minute. He said after an hour, my blood would not clot. And he said, this is not right. And he's a praying doctor as well. He's a Christian. And so I give all thanks to him every day. Because he hadn't given me any medication either. And he always said he knows that was God. Because if he had, they afterwards, when they realized what it was, they said if he had given me any medication, it would have masked what it was. And they would never have known.
My God.
And so I know God was in it all that time.
Can I interrupt you just
all that time?
Can I interrupt you just 1 second? All of this were you still operating, like going to classes, going to church?
Oh, no, because after I left class that night, I never got back.
Wow.
Because, as I said, things just deteriorated and very quickly. They were just trying to find answers. But then that same night, when my doctor took the blood and realized it was not clotting, he said, no, this is something very serious. We have to get her to the hospital. Something is not right here. So the ambulance came, and I went to the hospital. By that time now, I had to be put on oxygen because I couldn't breathe at all on my own. And they were trying to question me, ask me what was happening. They asked the parents permission to test me for everything, leptospirosis, AIDS, you name it. They asked their parents, and nothing was coming. They said that they were going to... they were going to have to go inside because they just could not figure out what was happening from the symptoms. They'd have to, you know, go inside and try to figure out what was happening because they just did not know what it was. They'd never seen it before. And by that time now, I wanted to sleep. I wanted to be out of my pain because it was very uncomfortable by then. And I just wanted to sleep. I wanted to be out of my misery. So I thought, yes, surgery is good because then I can sleep. Right? That
so
was my
you were
only
in
concern.
Tremendous pain.
Yes, very uncomfortable and just, you know, just uncertain and just tired and, you know, just wanted to sleep. And so they said they had to pump my stomach first. So they spent the night just emptying my stomach. They had to insert this gastric tube because obviously, you know, you would not be prepared for that. Usually before surgery, they tell you don't eat for about 24 hours or so. So they had to insert this tube through my nose, had to swallow, let it go down my throat, and they just pumped my stomach, and all night, I'm just, you know, they come in to check on me, and I'm just saying, you know, wondering when they could take me to surgery. All they could give me was a piece of wet gauze on my lips, and so on, just to, you know, moisten my lips and so on, but I couldn't eat anything, and oh boy, it was awful. And so then, very early in the morning now, when I saw the surgeon, I'm excited, thinking, yes, finally, he came and he said, we're not going to operate because if we cut you, you'll bleed to death.
Oh my goodness.
Yes.
And you're conscious all this time, so you're hearing this?
At that time, yes. Okay. At that time I was, and he said that to me. And so, in my heart, I was glad because that they'd figured that out before they cut me. But at the same time, I was saying, so what's going to happen now? Because I want to sleep. I just want to be out of this misery, right? So they said, well, you know, they're still trying to figure out what it was. They'd never seen anything like that before. He said it sent him back to his medical journals, And so when they were, every doctor, every consultant in the hospital was on this case because it was very new. And because I was so well known, as I, you know, everyone was concerned. This thing was, afterwards I realized how far reaching it was, because it was featured on the news every night here, the headline news. It was in the papers. It was all over the place. As far reaching as death row in the prison here, I got letters from persons on death row.
Wow.
Yeah, that was how far reaching this thing went. People telling me they're praying for me. I can't die. They look up to me so much. They depend on me so much, and they can't imagine in the world without me, and all that kind of thing. I was so shocked. Letters from members of parliament, you name it. It was unbelievable, the kind of outreach and response. Churches opened their doors and so on to pray. I mean, of all faiths, you know. I had no idea of this until afterwards, though.
But then,
right,
before you go on with the story, doesn't that just speak to how we live our lives here on earth?
Yes.
Can you speak to that just for a minute before you continue with the story? I mean, you told us about your upbringing and so on.
It's so true. And my grandfather used to say, you know, when you do good, good will attend you, you know. And when you love people, when you share a word with somebody, when you share something with somebody, when you live your life as God would have you, one of service, it is amazing then how that comes back to you. You know, you may not be looking for or expecting it or anything, and you don't do it with that in mind, you know. You're just living a life of service, and then, you know, it's amazing how the kind of returns that come from living that kind of life. But very often living that kind of life is difficult. It's hard because you suffer a lot sometimes.
Yes.
You have to make so much sacrifice.
Yeah.
You and your family, you know, financially, emotionally, everything, because everybody wants your time.
Right.
You don't want to say no. Somebody wants a word of encouragement, and you have to, you know, stop what you're doing to help them. Yeah. You know, they come in a difficult situation, and you have to forego something that you may plan to do. And so I set aside that money to do because this need is greater. So living that kind of life is hard. But, you know, then you realize the kind of joy you can bring to somebody's life, and the kind of difference you can make. Mm-hmm. It makes it all worth it, huh?
Absolutely, because, you know, it ties in with our devotions this morning. We studied, you know, about giving back and the pleasure that there is in joy giving. And, you know, Luke 6:38 says, you know, if you give, you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full measure, pressed down, shaken together.
Yes, shaken together,
to make
running
room
over.
For more and running over. Whatever measure you use in giving, whether you give in large measure or small measure, it will be used to measure what is given back to you. So I'm so thankful that you got that wonderful upbringing, so that when you were in need of prayer, that the whole nation could have rallied behind you in prayer. And does prayer work?
Oh yes, I am telling you. Mm-hmm. All faith. I mean, we even have a testimony from a guy who said to my dad, you know, he's an atheist, but we made him pray that
day.
Yeah, I mean, so I give God thanks for that. You know, it has been a tremendous story, and I always say to people that I it was a hard road to travel, but I'm honored that God chose me. I think he had to do it at that time, in that season, and with somebody who was so well known, to remind people that God still works miracles in this present time.
Amen. And that brings out another message right there, Mya. You're going to continue your story, but as you're going along...
I'm sorry, you're breaking up, Angela. I'm sorry, I missed you just now.
I'm saying that brings out another message there, Mya, because, you know, you're going to continue your story, but, you know, it brings out the message that, you know, every experience that we go through is for a reason, and it's to help somebody, you know?
Yes, that's right, because the first time I shared the testimony, because I used to say to my mother, I can never talk about this. It's too painful. It's too emotional. I can never talk about this. And she said, you know, you can't decide what God wants to do with his testimony. And so the first time I shared it, I looked back and saw my musicians behind me weeping with their instruments and weeping. And when I saw the young people get up out of their seats before I even got halfway and just flood the altar, I said, God, now I understand. It was like a eureka moment, huh? I said, God, now I understand. This was not about me necessarily. This was for the work he needed to do in somebody's life. You know, so I give God thanks, you know, give God thanks for that. And if I were to go on now,
yes, please.
The yeah, they said, you know, when this thing hit the news and so on, churches of all faiths opened up all day. I understand that people in establishment banks, media houses stopped and their staff prayed for little me, yes? And I thought, what? Me? Seriously? I mean, it attracted so much attention. It was amazing. This day, people still see me and stop and say, I prayed for you. I prayed for you.
Wow.
You know, ordinary people on the street, security guards, ordinary
wow.
people on the street, right?
Praise God.
And the thing is, when it was a very short space of time, you know, they said they tried to figure out what was happening. Nothing was happening. They couldn't tell what it was. The doctor said they had sent them back to their medical books and so on. And then they realized, God revealed, I should say, that I had contracted something called streptococci shock syndrome. And it's a bacteria that gets into your bloodstream and releases poisonous toxins and shuts down your organs one by one. And when they realized that that's what it was, the stage at which I was at, according to the medical journals, I had 24 to 48 hours to live.
What?
Yeah. So
what?
They brought this news to my parents and actually called them
wow.
and said, look, you need to get... They just left the hospital from a long night, got home to take a shower and go up, come back down. When they got a call saying, you need to come back here right away. We can't guarantee you that when you get here, that Maya will still be here, but you need to come now. Yeah. And so my mom and dad held each other, and as parents and as humans, they cried. Don't think that they didn't cry during this whole thing. They never let me see.
Right.
But they held each other,
wow.
You know, threw their arms around each other in the living room and said, God, we can't get there as fast as you can.
Right.
So we're asking you to go before us. Go
mm-hmm.
before us and, you know, and just, you know, do what you need to do
yes.
and heal our child.
Yes.
And my parents said when they got there, they were told... That. I'm sorry, Angela. Sorry.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, you're going to make all of us cry now. Because this is such a remarkable story, family. And I knew that we ought to let some more people around the world hear about the miracle working God that we serve. We're talking about over 10 years ago. We're talking about.
Oh, yeah. This was 1998.
Yes. And here we have a thriving young woman talking with us today about being brought back from the claws of death. The doctors are saying
I'm
to her parents that, you know, we're not sure. By the time you get back down to this hospital, we're not sure that your daughter Maya is going to be here because we just discovered what this disease is and we cannot
yes.
do anything about it. My God.
That's right. That's
tell,
right.
Tell
and
us a little bit about the
go.
Disease as well. What, because it was a rare disease, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. Very, very, very rare. I mean, at the time, they said that, I mean, after the whole thing settled down and so on, they said they'd received about 17 or 18 other reported cases in the world that they
in
were
the world,
aware of.
In the not in Barbados.
And I was the only survivor, Angela.
Oh my God.
Because
wow.
you see that my parents prayed that prayer.
Wow.
And they got to the hospital, they told them that the strange presence of a man
my God.
Entered the room.
Hallelujah. Jesus.
And all that was wrong started to go right.
Hallelujah. The mighty healer.
My dad said,
Yahweh
dad said, we know
Jesus.
Who that man is because we asked him to come.
Yes.
We asked him to go before us.
Hallelujah.
His
Jesus.
Name is Jesus.
My God. The great physician.
And that's why I'm here. The great
Jesus.
Physician.
Praise God. He just wants us to ask. He just wants
to
us to beckon. He just wants
that's
us
it.
To, he just wants us to ask
that's
and
it.
Believe.
That's it.
And believe.
And believe.
My God.
That's it. That's it. They said they'd never seen anything like it.
Wow.
So this is very strange presence
wow.
into the room, and everything that was going crazy just started to go right. And so, you know, so they just could not comprehend this thing because this is up to 17 or 18 other reported cases that came to their attention at the time, Angela. I was the only one who lived. Everybody else died.
Jesus.
So,
Jesus.
I know that God is real.
Hallelujah.
I know that God is real, and I know what he's done in my life.
Yes.
And so, that's why I have to, I have to worship. I have to share this testimony. I travel and share this testimony. I go around the island, the country, share this testimony, other islands. And every time, I mean, I used to think at one point, oh gosh, you know, this story is so old. People must be so tired of hearing this. And then somebody reminded me, don't forget, every time you share it, somebody else is hearing it for the first time.
Somebody new is hearing it. We're hearing it for the first time right here.
You know? Yes. Yeah, you know? And so it encourages me every time too. Mm-hmm. And so on. It raises my faith again.
Hallelujah.
It's been a source of encouragement to me over and over and over again. So I was going through difficult times and so on. And I keep hearing it in my head. But, you know, if he brought you back from death's door, right?
Jesus.
Then, you know, what you're going through here, this is minor. This is nothing for him to do.
Jesus,
nothing.
That's another message in itself right there.
Right there. He can do all things. He can do above and beyond what we could ask or think or even conceive, right? So they find out what it is. You know, the same 24 to 40 hours to live. But, you know, my God shows up. And they kept saying, no, she's still not out of the woods yet, but, you know, we're not, as opposed to plummeting, we kind of leveled off. So, excuse me, we just leveled off, and they're trying to figure out now how to treat this girl, what to do. Again, because it was so new, everybody else had died. So, they're trying to figure out what to do with this child. And, God, I believe God was in it all. He gave the revelation. And, they started to see, you know, slight turnarounds. I spent about 4 weeks in intensive care. Hooked up to all kinds of machines. I mean, I still have some scars to show. Tracheotomy as well, because but first I had the tube down my throat. And I remember between consciousness and unconsciousness, and I overheard a conversation. They forgot that they were, should not have spoken over me, but they thought I was totally out. But I could hear them saying that, you know, we have this tube down my throat. She's a singer. This could damage her vocal cords. We gotta find it out. We gotta get this out. And they said the machines went crazy, because in my spirit, I'm thinking, my vocal cords, you can't damage my vocal cords, you know? So they removed it from my throat like that way and did the tracheotomy then, which was just put a slit in my neck, outside now, and put the tube down there so that I could be hooked up to the machine. Now they said, well, they don't know if it was the fact that it had already been in there for certain lengths of time, that it caused the problem. But when I started to get better then, and so on, my vocal cords were paralyzed. I wasn't supposed to sing again, Angela. That's what they said.
Wow, that's what they said. Whose report will you believe?
Of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
So that was another journey in itself. So I mean, so imagine now we, you know, they figured out what they're doing. We're, you know, getting better. I had to have therapy to learn to walk again, to do everything for myself again. And then I go home now after 5 weeks, and I'm at home, and I've got this slit in my throat that would not heal, because this streptococcus shock syndrome depletes your body of all its nutrient content. So there's nothing in you at all. You got to start from zero. And so the wound in my neck would not heal at all. So that was the first step. They need to get the hole in my neck closed. If not, I'd have to be pressing my neck or ring a tracheotomy the rest of my life. So you could hear me. You would just hear this very garbled kind of sound as I spoke, right? I'd have to press this hole. Excuse me. And then, you know, if you'd hear something. But then all that would pass through was wind. And they said, well, your cords are paralyzed. And so they said, the first thing we've got to do is try and get this hole to close up. So they said if it wouldn't heal on its own, we'd have to stitch it up. And so my mom... my dad said, okay, we're going to have this thing stitched. So I said, you know, I am so tired of needles now, because, I mean, they used to have to stick me so much to get blood every hour.
My
and
goodness.
So on. It was so bad they couldn't find any veins.
Yes.
So they had to put this fine one, when they found one, they put this thing like a faucet on it.
Uh-huh.
And just turned it on to get blood every hour.
Oh, my goodness.
So I had enough of needles and so on, right?
Yes.
And so they said... Right, so my mom said, listen, you know, let's just pray. I said, Mom, they're stitching it tomorrow. And she said, well, look, our God is not a God of time and place. And
that's
he brought
right.
us far. And he started the work, he's ready to complete it. My dad is a giant. My mom is a little petite lady. She's like probably size 6. And so she stood there in my room with me, and she held my hands, and she prayed a very simple prayer. And because the tiny she is, she's a warrior, you know. very quiet warrior. And my mom just said this prayer with me. And so on. So the next morning, I'm going to the hospital now. They take the dressing off that I would have had on from the day before. And they're going to stitch. So they put all their equipment there to stitch the all this hole in my neck. And as we're there, so I'm there sitting, they come and so on, and the surgeon comes and so on. They take the dressing off, and I saw this expression on everybody's face who's looking at me now. And I'm thinking, oh dear, this thing has probably got, you know, gangrene or something now, when we're going a whole other ball game now. And they gave me a mirror and said, look at that. And that hole that was opened up to, you know, the size of a you would call it a 5 cent piece here, maybe a dime is 5 cents in the US, I think, maybe nickel, whichever one it is. I was opened up that size before, the day before, had closed up to the size of a pinhead overnight, so there was no need to stitch. Only a pin could fit through the hole. So from that gaping hole the day before, when they said they're going to stitch it the next morning.
Yes.
To be pinhead the next morning. You understand what my God did?
Hallelujah.
You know? Yes. I just said, I had enough needles. I don't want any more. And he heard that.
Hallelujah.
And overnight closed this hole up. So there was no need to stitch.
Let's break for a minute and continue with the story from there. I just want to give you some feedback from the folks who are listening. We have YCC in South Ozone Park in New York was asking you to repeat what the disease was called. But we had a bright student in Toronto, Canada, who listed it, who named it out. We have a chat room session going on here so they can type so that I can see their responses. And so, but uh-huh. Can you just tell us what the disease is again? For the sake of YCC.
Streptococci shock syndrome.
And it's very, very rare. Very, very rare.
Yes.
Only about 15 people around the world had it. And you're the only survivor today. Have you heard of anybody else contracting that since then?
Well, no. The thing is, people always contact me or my parents when they've got something strange happening at the hospital, like, or their relatives who've got some strange thing and they can't figure out what it is. And they're trying to ascertain whether it could be what I had, right? But we've never heard anybody actually use that term again,
okay.
Right? It's been other things, but never heard of any diagnosis of that particular thing.
Wow.
It's mine.
Okay.
Things like it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We have Sister Jean in Grenada. She's saying, wow.
Yeah.
This is what the body of Christ needs to be doing more. We need to blast the airwaves proclaiming that God is the miracle working God. Every time we put on the radio or television, we hear what the devil is doing. So we need to use social media more to tell about the miracles that God is doing. He is performing miracles, but people are not speaking about them enough. So, you know, we laud you, we commend you. And even though you break down, Maya, when you're talking about it, because I'm sure it must be very emotional 12 years later, how many years later? But you know, God gives you the strength to continue to talk about it, because I tell you, as you said, every time you talk about it, somebody new is hearing about the miracle working God that we serve, and they're being encouraged. And that's your purpose. That's your purpose in life. You know, Sister Jean also wants to know if you or somebody wanted to know if Yes, Sister Jean. She wants to know if you have written a book yet about your story.
I've had that question so many times, right? It took me a while to get the album done. That in itself was a costly exercise, but people have been calling for a book now ever since. But the album was a mammoth task in the first place. And I know that, you know, maybe that's something that God wants me to do, and maybe that the book will happen. I even had one of the doctors who was in the emergency room that night, who strained enough ended up coming before me as a client, not knowing who I was.
Oh dear.
Or knowing this. It was so weird, and he just started asking me if I had a tracheotomy, and I said yes, and then we started talking. Oh my gosh, you have a girl. And he said, you know, I told him not to worry, because you weren't going to make it. He asked me, he paid me an apology and so on, and asked me to forgive him. And I said, of course I do. Of course, you could only work with what you're seeing in the natural.
Absolutely,
you know?
Absolutely.
But something else was happening in the spiritual.
Mm,
you know, so that's not your fault. But he said, you know, like, if I'm writing a book, he will do all he can to get all the information available to me, because he said, I'll never understand medically how ill I was.
Wow.
He said, you'll never be able to comprehend in the medical world how ill you were, Maya. You should not have lived. I'm telling you.
God, I'm telling you. But all of your surgery was done in Barbados, was it? Was it not?
But yes.
Like I said,
No. Everything happened here, and I know it was all God. God was in it from the beginning to the end. I know that for a fact. All the procedures were done here, right?
Okay, you can continue with the testimony now. I'm not sure where you left off. I hope you know.
Yes. We were talking about the fact that after I'd gone home and so on, we had a problem of, apart from, you know, getting my body generally back to, you know, building every nutrient content and building my strength up and so on and learning to do things myself again. I had this issue with my voice. The vocal cords were paralyzed, and the first step was to healing. That was to first get the slit where the tracheotomy was inserted in my throat to close. I remember they were going to stitch it because it wouldn't close on its own. And then my mom prayed, and by the next morning when they went to stitch, it had closed the size of a pinhead. Yeah. So amen to that. So there we go now, and then. So we got that. So that's closed now, but there's still no sound. I still have to press it to hear, you know, this garbled kind of noise. And all these persons met, and these specialists met with me, and so on. And they said, well, look, you know, we can't ever guarantee you a singing voice ever again, but we're going to try to see what we can do with this to give you a speaking voice back. They said that they would, there was this procedure that could be done where they could insert some cartilage in my vocal cords to try to get them to limber up a bit, to see if they would, you know, get them to move, because they were just not moving at all. And so the interspecialist said he was going up to meet with the surgeons overseas, I think it was in Boston, and come back and then tell me what's happening. And while he was gone, we were praying on this end. And a good friend of mine told me about doing some steam inhalation. There's something called Friar's Balsam. So as I was using this Friar's Balsam every night, I would inhale through my mouth and exhale through my nose. And as I inhaled, I would say, in Jesus' name.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Oh, yes.
Because I don't tell anybody that Friar's Balsam did it, you know, because I don't know that it did. All I can tell you is that I used it, but I said with every breath, I said, in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
And I said, I had a discussion with God, and I said, God, look, you cannot give me a testimony like this and then don't give me the voice to be able to share it, though. That doesn't add up. That's not the kind of God you are. That's not the kind of God you are. That doesn't make any sense. So you have to do something. You have to give me my voice back so I can tell somebody. You have to be able to do that. And by the time the doctor came back and I walked into his office in the morning, and he came in and he's now ready to tell me how we're going to proceed with this surgery, right? And so on, he comes in, he says, morning, Maya. And with his back to me, not expecting anything, I said, good morning.
No way.
And he almost fell out of the chair.
Oh, my goodness.
I'll never forget that.
Oh, hallelujah.
He said, what happened here? How does that happen? I said, Friar's Balsam and prayer, right? He was so blown away. He said, well, oh, wow. He said, well, this is a development here. Maybe we don't need to go any further. And he said, you know, let's just keep up with this for a while and so on, and, you know, take your time and so on and so forth, and, you know, don't rush into anything. As yet, you have to give the court time to heal, and so, which is true, you know. And to get them to limber up and get them back to where they were and so on. And, yeah, so that was another journey in itself. But, yes, as you're hearing me speaking today and you've heard my music that was recorded after this whole ordeal, that album came out of this experience. That's what it's called, With Every Breath I Testify, because my lungs had collapsed during the whole ordeal, and my lungs always were compromised. That was the most severe thing about this thing, that the lungs had totally collapsed. And what happened was, I mean, I couldn't even go into AC, couldn't go upstairs for a long time, because everything just took too much out, was too much pressure for my lungs. And I remember they'd given me this thing called an incentive respirator, So they said I had to use this thing and show them that, you know, I can, my lungs are functioning at a capacity that they felt comfortable sending me home. And so this machine, this little thing, a little gadget, plastic gadget with some balls in these chambers, and you have to be able to breathe into this chamber, take a breath, and the balls will go up. Or breathe in this chamber, the balls will go up, and you've got to be able to hold the balls at the top of the chamber. And I remember the first time I took a breath, the balls would not move. The balls rattled in the bottom of the chamber, and they said, oh no, you got to do this every hour. We got to see how you're doing it. Every hour on the hour, you got to try this thing so you can get the balls to the top. I used to cry and cry and cry because I could not get the balls to move. That's how bad my lungs were. So every breath for me now is a big deal.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Because you thought about, you never thought about those things before, but now you realize that every breath is a miracle.
And I want to stick a pin right there. I want to stick a pin right there. And let's see, I think we have a little. Maya, are you there still?
Yes, I am.
Okay, all right. Yeah, let's stick a pin right there. Every breath that I take is a miracle. I want to develop that just a bit, but I want to just welcome some folk who have joined us from the U.S. Virgin Islands, from Louisville in Colorado, from Philadelphia in Pennsylvania, and from Massachusetts. We want to thank you so much for joining us today. We are talking with Mya Daniel out of Barbados. She's a singer, songwriter. She's an attorney. She's a mediator. She's a preacher's kid. She's a wife and a mother. And she has this remarkable testimony where back in 1998, she was struck by this rare illness where only about 15 people around the world had ever contracted it. And she, so far, to the best of our knowledge, or to the best of her knowledge, is the only survivor. And she is a living, breathing, walking, talking miracle today. And she is proclaiming that God, the God that we serve, is a miracle working God. And so she has taken us through her childhood, her upbringing, and she has told us about her illness and her recovery to date. And we're going to get into her music, her album that she has produced that we play here on Joy Gospel Radio FM. But you said something just before I interrupted you. Every breath that you take is what?
Yes, a miracle.
Is a miracle. You know, a lot of us in this world, we tend to take life so not seriously, for the want of a better term. You know, we tend to fuss about so many things that, you know, when you look back, they're really simple in comparison to what some other folk are going through. Having gone through what you go through, Mya, and I think you mentioned it earlier on, relationship issues, financial struggles, you get in an accident or something, these things pale in comparison. How do you deal with the struggles that you face today? Because I know that you face struggles still. You're human. We're in this world. How do you deal with the struggles that you face today when you look back to where God has brought you from and knowing who it is that you serve?
Yes, I'm telling you, every time I reach a point in my life, because I don't think that because you went through such a major ordeal, and you were triumphant, God was victorious, he came through and you were healed, that it stops there. You know, don't think the enemy's not going to come back. He comes back even more, and he comes back harder, because he realizes, no, well, okay, well, every time this girl wakes up in the morning, she's a threat to me. And so he comes hard every time. And so, you know, he comes with all kinds of distractions, things to shake your faith, to rattle your nerves. And every time I have to minister, he always finds a way to attack my throat, my sinuses, my vocal cords, always. So I'm preparing now, actually, for ministry on Saturday. A concert friend of mine is launching his album. It's called Second Chances. And he's featuring me and my testimony in the second half. And so, again, he's at me from the weekend. You know, I was down and out. One and now, you know, hoarse and congested, and it's always the same thing. But the thing is, before I used to be intimidated, and I would call and say, oh dear, I can't make it, I'm not feeling well, because I was afraid of what would come out. I didn't want to take the chance of embarrassing myself on stage, or making, you know, the person's event a flop. And then I realized, but wait a minute though, the enemy is getting the glory every time you do this, is what he wants. So I made a decision that, and this is my mantra, if I have to lay down and cork it out, I am coming.
My God.
I'm going to be there because I realize that, you know, it doesn't matter how it sounds to my ear, there's a purpose for it. And I don't have to worry about that. And amazingly enough, sometimes no matter how awful I think I sound leading up to, sometimes I would get to the event and I have no voice at all. I would be, and I'm just as I'm going on stage, I'm thinking, you idiot, you know, why would you go up there and embarrass yourself? You know, tell the people you can't do it. You can't share the testimony. You can't sing. And I would go up there, you know, and just submit to God. And when I open my mouth, I would be blown away by what I hear. And nobody believes that before I went on, I could not even sing a note. Or that when I spoke you, it was so, it's unbelievable every time without fail. So I went to rehearsal last night and I said to my friend, I said, right, you don't worry. I said, we are on the right track because, you know, with these kinds of attacks, we know that we are doing the right thing. The enemy is better than what's going to happen on Saturday. And that's why we're seeing all of this. That's why I've been so ill. And that's why, you know, I've been feeling this and why I'm so hoarse. I mean, last night I didn't think I could do the rehearsal. And I said, God, no, I am going to do this rehearsal. And I opened my mouth and I was in awe. When I finished, I couldn't sing another note, though. When I finished, it shut down. Hoarse, not on that hoarse. I said to him, do not panic by what you see. I said, don't worry, Saturday is going, everything is going to be just fine. So I've committed myself now to, you know, showing up and doing it with all I have, and giving God whatever I have and letting Him do the rest. And little becomes much in His hand. So even that, every time you face those kinds of challenges and those kinds of intimidating kind of scenarios and daunting events, God reminds me, when I see how He comes through, when I see what He does, it reminds me that He is in charge and that He's got it all in control, and we are not to be intimidated by the lies of the enemy, because that's His plan. That's His plan to distract and dissuade us from fulfilling God's purpose for our lives. And if I were to give in to everybody, give Him every time He threatens me with, you know, this issue here with my throat, I'm telling you, I would never have told this story. Never. I would never have sung again or anything like that. I'm telling you. But every time, the you know, what God does something amazing every single time. So I don't care now what I'm going. I don't care how I don't care how in the natural it seems like I can't do it. No, I go and I give it to Him, and it's amazing what he does and how He shows up. So, you know, to anybody out there who is feeling challenged, who's feeling like they just can't get out of the situation, they seem to be facing something that's so insurmountable. You know, remember, that's what you're seeing in the natural, but, you know, our God is super. So when we invite Him to impose Himself on what we see in the natural, that's when the supernatural happens. Our super, right, imposes Himself on what we see in the natural. Yes. That's when miracles happen. And that's what faith is. Faith is trusting when we can't trace, you know.
Yes.
Faith is exactly that. You know, just functioning when we cannot understand what's happening.
Yeah.
Believing when everybody else thinks that we're crazy. Mm-hmm. Because what we're seeing in the natural does not make sense. You understand?
Hallelujah.
So yes,
when the doctor came in and he said good morning, and you said good morning, what happened after that?
Oh, well, I mean, it was uphill from there. He couldn't believe it. There was nothing else for him to do, really. But, you know, ask me how this happened and so on. So I shared with him a bit, and he said, well, okay, let's see how it goes. And, you know, we just had a couple of checks after that and so on. But he never had to do the surgery, insert any cartilage or anything like that, you know. So I give God thanks for that to this day. And then my album was birthed, and my daughter, too, because they said, you know, my body had been through so much, and it was just functioning so irregularly. It was so off. Everything was just off. Even after, you know, we got into a semblance of normalcy and whatever they said, and met my soulmate and got married and so on, they said having children was, you know, virtually a no-no. And again, we had to go into God with that.
Yes.
And God led me to the right doctor, because the one I had before had just basically written me off and so on, and led me to the right doctor, and we put some more prayer in, and then my daughter showed up. After I let go, and I said, right, I said, God, look, this is yours. I'm tired. I am tired. I let go of the reins because I was holding the reins myself, yes, thinking that I could make this thing happen. Mm-hmm. And I let go of the reins, and I could not believe it. When I went to this doctor, unknown doctor, just saying that I had gas, and I couldn't understand why, you know, and I thought I just needed, like, a purge, and she said, oh, well, you know, let me be the first to congratulate you. I said, on what, you know, and you're pregnant. I said, what?
Hallelujah.
What?
Wow.
I'm telling you. So she is a miracle too. Her name is Genesis.
And she's
we chose that
now?
Name. Especially,
she's seven now.
Tell us
about the name,
seven
Genesis.
Now. Genesis, yes. Well, you know, before she was even, you know, conceived and whatever, we were, my husband and I were traveling, and he said, did you hear, he said, we were in the lobby, and he said, did you hear what that lady called her granddaughter? I said, no. He said, Genesis, he said, when we have a child, once she's a girl, can we call her that? I said, I love it. And we talked about the significance. He said, you know, because it would be a new beginning for us, and, you know, a fresh start. And I said, it would be perfect. So then, you know, we didn't know what the sex of the child, so we worked on both names, but some, I asked God, I'd always ask God to give me the opportunity to be a mother and also to give me a girl. And so then she came out and I said, what is it? And she said, it's a girl. I said, ah! You know, I said, oh my goodness. I said, Genesis is her name, Genesis. And it was our beginning indeed, a fresh start, a reminder of God's awesome power and how he can, you know, he can just wipe your slate clean and he can, you know, he can just, you know, start you off on a new track. And put all those negative tongues, you know, he can, you know, quiet them.
Yeah. So I want to get into the album, yes, Mya, because time is going, but from your illness, from this,
yes,
rare illness, you hardly have any what you may call it, and any symptoms now from this illness. You're well, you're whole.
No. Not at all.
Wow.
I am whole.
Praise
God. As apart from this constant, sinus issues that I have every now and again.
Uh-huh.
A friend of mine, who is from my band, one of my main members, he says to me, you know, that's probably just part of your story. That is to keep you dependent on God.
Aye.
So that every time you go to minister,
yes,
you know, it's not in yourself. It is not, you have to depend on him every time,
yes,
because this attack comes every time, right?
Wow.
So that's just part of my journey.
It's a reminder. It's like the rainbow.
That, you know?
It's like the rainbow that God sends to remind,
yes,
us that he'll never,
right,
destroy the world by flood again. Wow, God is an amazing,
yes,
God. Everything he does,
yes,
is well,
yes,
done. And it's for
well
a purpose.
Done. Well
it's for
done.
A purpose. So you're singing
so nothing
again.
Residual.
Nothing
oh,
residual.
Absolutely.
That's awesome. So tell us about the album.
So yes, so while I was in the hospital, God told me you're going to do an album. Of course, at that time, because I was so sick, I thought he was crazy. He said, you're going to do an album, and it was going to be called This Every Breath I Testify. That was in 1998, and that album was released when I was pregnant in 2009. This Every Breath I Testify, did a big launch and everything, and every song. I said, God, I want you to give me an album that's not just for now. I don't want an album that, you know, you play it now, and it's you know, it's in you know, a year or two or three, it's dead, you know, according to the saying, it's outlived its shelf life. I want to leave something that will outlast all the others. I want something that will be timeless. And he took me to, you know, the right writers, he took me to the right musicians, right everybody, and these songs were birthed, and yeah, because I would have written once, writing one or two myself, but then there were other people that I knew that, you know, had something to say, and that could say it well, experienced writers, and who could capture this vision, and they rolled with it, and I'm telling you, just they asked God for something timeless. I mean, as I said, we're in 2016 now, and people still want it. People still buying on CD Baby, you know, Amazon. People are still asking me to come and share the testimony and, you know, want to purchase the album. They request this up to this morning on the radio. Someone called and requested I've to love it back. You know, it received major rotation, right? And that's what I asked God for. And he's given me that. He's honored me and favored me. And me, with that, to know that it still encourages somebody. I got an email from someone just last week. Her mother is in hospital, not well at all. They don't know what's happening. She said, but, you know, every time she listens to God's Love and Back, it really, really, really recharges her, gives her strength to go on and so on. And, you know, so I get those kinds of testimonies all the time. All the time. I got testimonies from a lady in St. Lucia whose son is a Rastafarian, and he doesn't like gospel music. She plays it, and he slams doors and gets very violent. And she put mine in, and by the time it got to track three with Titi, he'll bring the son. He would put the thing on repeat.
Yes.
So as opposed to slamming doors and breaking up furniture, uh-huh. He's actually listening, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And putting the album on repeat, okay? Yeah. Things like that. People who have told me stories of persons who were on deathbed and just wanted to hear the album as they transitioned from this life to the next. You know, people who in the last days just thought, you know, found so much comfort in it, you know? People who were just at the lowest low and needed to hear something, and people tell me all the time that it lifts their spirits, takes them from that state of doubt and impossibility to a state of possibility, you know? So I feel after this whole ordeal, it's as if you had a eureka moment and you realize what your purpose is. And that you are now fulfilling that purpose. I was ministering before, you know, singing everywhere and so on. But when this happened, it was as if everything had come together. Everything. Never in a million years would we have imagined, or never would have imagined our family that this would have happened. Never my ministry would have anticipated this would have happened. I mean, at all. Mm-hmm. At all. You know, but ultimately, test comes the testimony, yeah?
Hallelujah.
And so,
hallelujah.
You know, that got for different ministry. I never wanted a ministry, you know, of just hype, and I wanted a ministry that would be lasting, that would be life-changing. Mm-hmm. Always, always, always wanted that. And you know, he's blessed me with that. And so it's an honor for me to share. It's a real privilege for me to tell somebody else about God's goodness and his awesome power. He did it for me. He can do it for you.
Amen. And I can certainly testify to the timeliness of the music, because I tell you, she is in her early 20s. I have three daughters, one in her early 20s. The other one is a teenager who has just registered at law school in UE. And she's the one, and well, there's a teenager who's 13. But the middle one, who's mm-hmm. 19, she's the one who sent me, "I've Got to Love Him Back." That's the song,
oh, wow,
that I was introduced to you by. You know, she heard it and she shazammed it. There's this app that you have on your smartphones that you can find out what songs are and who sings them and so on. And she sent it to me, and, you know, that was the beginning of all of this. And so, yes,
wow,
you are reaching the young people as well. And that's important, you know, because...
Wow, yes, it is.
It's so very important that you can reach the masses, because, you know, you reach the older ones.
Yes, that is so true.
You know, so that's awesome.
That is so true. I'm considered here as to be one of the more seasoned generation of gospel music here and gospel ministers here, because I would have started from so long ago, right? I celebrate my 40th birthday this year, and so I would have started from when I was in school long, long ago. But God has allowed me to to transition between the older generation and the younger one, and for that I'm truly grateful.
Amen. Amen.
And He's done that with this testimony, because although it happened a long time ago, I was young. I was 20, 21, you see? So it reaches the young people. I was at UE, just like all of them.
Right.
You see what I mean?
Yeah, see?
So
it speaks
to them once I start.
Wow. You know,
yeah.
I must really tell her that story, because it's so ironical to a certain extent, but I tell you, God moves in mysterious ways, and, you know, God knows what that can do for her as well. You know, So we thank God for your testimony, Maya. We really, really, you know, bless God
for manifesting
His miracle working power in your life, so that you can be alive today to share with others, and so that others can be blessed as well. You know, God is alive.
Yes.
He is real.
He is real.
And there is nothing that we face in this world.
Nothing.
Some nameless disease could not thwart the plans of our God for our lives.
Yes.
And we are so thankful for that. So God bless you.
You
said you're celebrating, or you celebrated, or you are going to celebrate your 41st.
Yes, but my birthday was in July, but we're celebrating all year. I'm actually leaving you shortly to get ready to go to a belated birthday lunch.
Oh. from July.
Yes, my former colleague of mine said, no matter when we do it, we have to go and celebrate. Who would have thought? 40? Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
So, yeah, so we're celebrating all year, doing a big family group trip to celebrate in December. So, yeah, we are really thankful for what God has done, what He's doing, what He's going to continue to do. So we're celebrating big.
Amen. And earlier on in the chat room, we heard from Marilyn in Barbados as well. We've got some listeners in Barbados. Marilyn said she was privileged to meet you at a funeral earlier this year. I'm not sure if you remember. Actually, her name
yes.
is Marilyn
and
Daniel.
She was Oh wow!
Yes.
And she was the lady that said to me that you were trained,
yes.
that your daughter had
yes.
heard me, and that you wanted to interview me, and
yes.
so on. Amazing, huh?
Yes, indeed. So thank you, Marilyn. Really appreciate that.
Yes, thank you, Marilyn.
You know,
thank
God
you, thank you.
God connects His people all over the world. We are so grateful. We are so grateful. So
yes, and I really want to say as well, you know, I mean, to all those who are listening,
mm-hmm.
And so on. You know, you can't just talk God. You gotta live God. And even when I was doing the album, doing the recording, my friend always wanted to remember to say this, that, you know, I had prayer warriors and so on all around me, all around this project. And even in the booth, you know, we had, you know, just for one of the songs, I think My Life Is In Your Hands, in the middle of it, you hear, you know, like almost like a call and response, like where I speak some word. And I brought prayer warriors and worshippers into the booth to just, you know, worship, just declare God. And I mean, this was in a studio at a time that wasn't necessarily a Christian studio, but I wasn't ashamed to let them see, you know, what the God we serve, and to understand the perspective from which we are coming, you know, and so that they could get the message as well. Yeah? Mm-hmm. So in every aspect of that album, everything, you know, I want God to be reflected.
Amen, amen. So just, thank you again, and if there is one more thing
thank
that you,
Angela.
Want to just let people resonate in people's mind about your whole testimony and your life, what is it that you want people to remember about your testimony?
There's a passage of scripture that took us through this whole thing, and it features a lot in the testimony, and it features in that song as well, My Life Is In Your Hands, my version of My Life Is In Your Hands, Psalm 46 verse 1. That's our family scripture. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Present means now. You need a now? He's here now. Yes. And that's what I want people to take away. He is a present help in trouble.
Amen. God bless you, Mya. God bless you.
God bless you too, Angela. Thank you so much for having me. It was an honor.
That's Mya Daniel, family out of Barbados. Oh, what a remarkable testimony. God is alive. He is real. He still does miracles. He loves us. He is faithful. What a mighty God we serve. Want to thank us so very much for spending some time with us today. It's been my pleasure to have her. Thank God for allowing her to be so gracious to spend some time with us today. And we pray that you were blessed. Somewhere along the line, we lost our chat room. But the folks, some of you were able to get your questions in and send your feedback, and we're grateful for that. Thank you so much for being here with us today, family, once again. Another Wednesday interview. We trust that you are all blessed. May the peace of the Lord, which passes all understanding, rest, remain, and abide with all of us, now and forevermore. Shalom, family. Love you muchly. I'll catch you tomorrow, God's willing. Classic Oldie Goldies, Throwback Thursday.
My life is from the jaws of death you snatched me. Gave me a second chance. Satan really thought he had me. Said I'd never praise again. God had a different story. He had a different plan. He touched and healed my body.